So I'm doing a fasting mimicking diet event this week. I'm basically just doing the Prolon fasting mimicking diet. It's a 5-day diet, 1,100 calories day one, 800 calories, 600 to 800 calories days two through five. Why am I doing that? Well, here's the thing. Over the past couple of years, we've seen hundreds of patients and dozens upon dozens have lost huge weight, 30 pounds or more. You just don't see that unless you're working in an intense individual person-to-person environments, which our the PrevMed practice is. Here's the typical pattern that these people are using to lose that kind of weight. First, they go low carb, and that hardens the body. I say harden. Here's what happens. You quit getting these ups and downs of glucose, your blood glucose. So your hunger decreases dramatically. And that's why people lose weight well on the low-carb diet. But here's there's a next step. And the next step is this. They close their eating window. It's called time-restricted diet, time-restricted eating. And basically for most of them, what that means is skipping breakfast. If you read Longo, who's into this fasting mimicking diet, you would say, he would say breakfast is still very important. It's better to skip dinner. For social reasons, most of us skip breakfast and not dinner. And that's fine. But I can't, so again, I've got a lot of people losing a lot of weight, but I can't get people to take me up on the suggestion for fasting. I do it. I've done water fasts. I've done one-day water fasts for 1 day per week for years. I stopped when I was in my last full-time activity with Physician Partners. It's a prevention program for Medicare folks. Great program. But I was the chief science officer and traveling, working with 700 docs, teaching prevention. I was traveling too much and eating too much and, focused on other things. It's hard to focus on your health as much when you travel. Anyhow, bottom line is I gained 10 pounds. I got over 160. I notice impacts on my health, like atrial fib, some of the other, and some of my markers. I've covered those in other videos. Bottom line, 6 months ago when I retired again to focus full-time on this channel and the PrevMed practice, and I started doing 2 days per week water fast. Back down to the low 150s, and haven't had an episode of AFib since then. But again, fasting is very, very, fasting beyond intermittent fasting, beyond low carbs, fasting itself is a huge benefit to your health. It's just very difficult to get people to do it. I'm not the first person to have that problem. That's exactly why Walter Longo developed the fasting mimicking diet. Fasting is, again, great benefit, but it's hard to get people to do it. So the idea is to give foods that don't have as, A, it's not as much food, and B, it's decreased protein, some decrease in fat, some of the things that tend to drive some of the biomarkers that we're wanting to decrease, like growth hormone, things like that. So somebody asked me in the event last night about the Warburg effect. Now, that is a very interesting point. It has to do with cancers. And I thought, you know what? A lot of people know about weight loss and fasting, but they don't know about cancer. So this is going to be a quick video. Well, maybe, you know me, maybe not so quick. It's going to be a video on fasting and cancer, and specifically the fasting mimicking diet and cancer. You get lower levels of IGF-1, growth factor, lower levels of glucose, higher ketones, and those second and third items, the lower glucose, higher ketones, have a lot to do with the Warburg effect, which we'll talk about in just a minute. And you get higher growth factor inhibition. You start thinking about that, decreased growth, that's what cancer is all about. With a fasting mimicking diet, lower proteins, lower sugars, it does have more carbs in it than the other than protein or fat, but it's complex carbs, rich in healthy fats, and it was the precursor of today's Prolon. Now, what has this got to do with, actually, there's a military history component to this. And if you read Longevity Diet by Longo, he brings this up. So as the 1812, Napoleon and Waterloo, the attack, the French attack of Russia. Here's what happened. This is a ugly story, but again, cancer is an ugly item as well. So the French attacked the Russians. Instead of the Russians bearing the brunt of the French attack in the summer, they continued to retreat throughout the summer and the fall. And they burned their own villages as they did. So the French continued to attack, but again, this was sort of the attack was slowed down dramatically by the Russian retreat. After months of starvation, they were then in the winter, which created freezing conditions and major advantage for the Russians. In the final attack at around Waterloo, there were 400,000 casualties for the French. And that's where you get the term Napoleon met his Waterloo. That's not the first time those kind of retreats have been used to for military advantage. Rome and Carthage, a whole bunch of others. I'm probably already too deep and too long into that thing. But look at cancer. This is lung cancer, adenocarcinoma and mesothelioma. And normal diet, chemotherapy, fasting, and fasting plus chemotherapy. As you see, adding fasting to the chemotherapy causes great improvement in treatment for these cancer therapies. And again, it's sort of, why does it do that? It's sort of like the Russians retreating and burning their villages. The cancer doesn't have much to live on. Which brings up the Warburg effect. Otto Warburg was a German biochemist in the 1920s. He noticed that cancer cells were stuck in overgrowth mode. And when you think about it, that's actually exactly what cancer is. It's tissue that is stuck growing, constantly active, and it won't stop. So you're growing like it's growing like a cancer. So Warburg also noticed one other thing. He said, you know what? These cancer cells tend to be very dependent on glucose. So he decided to remove the fuel, and his discoveries led to what's called the Warburg effect and a keto diet for cancer, which is used for a lot of cancers. It doesn't work for all, but again, it's used for a lot. For a lot of them, if you haven't heard of it, look it up. Now, when you look at actual fasting, rather than just a keto diet, fasting removes all the fuel for cancer cells. So fasting has a significant impact, just like a Warburg effect or low carb, again, as you see here. So clinical trials, this was they did water only, they did 72-hour fast, and found that it was better than 24-hour fast. And FMD was often found as effective as chemo. Now, what clinical trials am I talking about? Let me see if I can find that. Yeah, BMC cancer. So this was an article, back in 2016, and they're comparing fasting components with platinum-based chemotherapy. This is not a Longo research. This is other folks that are, again, way deep into cancer research. What did they do? They basically took cancer patients that were going to be taking platinum-based chemotherapy. If they could take a 24-hour fast, they had them do it. If they could they had them do that and go on to a 48-hour fast. And if they could do the 48-hour fast, they went on to a 72-hour fast. Then they did some things to look at the impact of the chemotherapy on monocyte DNA. Why did they do that? Well, here's what they're doing. They're looking to see how much damage was occurring to the host, the women that had this type of cancer. And here's what they found. This is no fasting. This was 24-hour fasting, 48 hours, and 72 hours. You notice that the women that were able to make it through a 72-hour fast had greatly decreased damage to the DNA in their blood cells. So again, that's where it gets back to that concept of if you're fasting, it's like the Russians retreating. You're decreasing the fuel available for growth. Then you're also not only protecting some of your own cells, you're also adding further damage to the cancer cell. some other research that's been done, if you look at fasting mimicking diet specifically and laboratory rats, I covered this in a couple of videos back. This was only mentioned cancer and FMD, fasting mimicking diet, briefly. Basically what happened was they saw later onset of cancers and fewer of them. So these were the control mice. These were the mice that received the fasting mimicking diet. The round dots were the cancer onset and the cancers in the control group. The squares were the cancers in the other group, the FMD group. As you see, the control group started in about 20 months getting cancers, and the FMD group of mice didn't start getting cancers until age 24 months. So again, significant research behind fasting and specifically being able to do mimicked fasting and the impact on cancer. Now, a little bit more stuff. Doxorubicin toxicity in humans is increased with dexamethasone, but so is the impact, the efficacy. So there's now a recommendation of not using steroids with doxorubicin unless fasting is also used as well, for just the reasons that we went over a few minutes ago. As I often do, I am getting way too long-winded. So let me just wrap it up with a couple of other points. So what's going on from a biochemical perspective? You're getting improvement in insulin, glucose, ketones, growth factor. You're getting other improved markers with your fasting. So, and you're getting improvement in the response to cancer and cancer treatment. Longo has been quoted as saying maybe it's preventive. And I think we all have to ask that same question. Does fasting also help prevent cancer? If you've made it this far, thank you very much for your interest. So Janice Derrickson, Dr. Derrickson, is my wife, but she's also our health educator, our health coach. she likes to tell me that she doesn't have time to view my videos. And I understand. The one that published today was 15 minutes. I look at a lot of YouTube videos as well, and when one's that as long as that, I just sort of cringe. So I'm looking to do some shorter videos. This one's on LPPLA2 and cardiovascular inflammation, and we talk a little bit about the course. You know, it's very interesting, and I've covered this before. Time magazine back in 2004 in February said, look, there's a secret killer. Inflammation causes heart attacks, cancer, and Alzheimer's, as well as other diseases. Here we are 15 years later, and the medical community, it's not a standard for treatment or even investigation. That's unfortunate, despite the fact that there is testing available. How do you find it? I've got a whole course on it. It takes you less than 2 hours. And it's a little bit less than $30. So go to our homepage, go down to the bottom, click on it, and you'll find inflammation, the inflammation course. If your doc's not interested, it tells you how to get the tests even without a doc. But here's another idea. Just maybe think about buying this course for your doc. It's worth your time. Thank you much for your interest.